Welcome back. Vanessa Williams once banged out this absolute beauty in 92. And no words truer spoken here on the Coast to Coast podcast because we've waited, it's 2 years now.
Yeah.
And we finally got the big fella in some red hot season long form. TK, Tim Kelly, welcome to the program.
Boys, thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to finally get on.
It's our pleasure to bring you inside. You didn't know this room existed, did you?
No, I didn't. It's the first time.
And the big fella's actually saying, where do you guys film this? Like in the basement somewhere? Like, no, mate, we got a studio upstairs. What's going on, man? How are you?
Oh, man, you know.
Off the 3-0 performance on the weekend, feeling good or what?
Look, you know, you take the win, man, for sure. Like, you know, we needed it.
Yeah.
It was a much-needed win for the group. Nice to play well. So, yeah, nice for it all sort of come together. And, yeah, like we touched on, one to get. Be nice to go out on a high. But, yeah, at the same time, looking forward to a good break.
You know what they say, mate? It's nice to you want to play well, but it's better to win, but it's better when you do both.
Big time. When you have a first quarter like you do there, TK, and then they still don't send someone to you, are you just licking lips going, this is rare?
Yeah, I mean, well, yeah, normally when you start heating up, they tend to send someone to you pretty quick. So, I'll take it. So, normally I reckon I've started most games this year and had someone sort of come to me pretty quickly. So, it was nice to get those.
All right. So, I've never had someone tag me. Like, I'm a forward, so I've always got someone playing on me.
So, yeah, that's tagged.
But as a midfielder, it's very different. Are you ever, like, halfway through the first quarter, had 8 touches on fire just thinking, look, I'm going to have to calm a jet tier or someone's going to come play on me the rest of the day? Or is that it not even cross your mind? It's like, I'm just going as hard as I can. And if someone comes to me, it's just not an issue. I'll just get it sorted anyway. Like, how does your thought process
business
go?
Decisions, you reckon?
Like, look, I could go and get that ball, but if I get that one, they might send one to me.
Yeah, I reckon that's funny you said that, but no, I don't reckon that's ever crossed my mind.
Didn't think it would.
Yeah, no, I don't reckon it's ever crossed my mind. You just want to, in the moment, you just want to play and yeah, you're not really thinking much. You just, every quarter, you play the quarter out and then you see where you're at quarter time or half time, three quarter time. So, you're not really thinking, I shouldn't get any more touches here because someone will come to me. Yeah, not really thinking that.
Weird year though, TK, because you go from having on one side of the fence, you have a career year, like you found your best AFL form to date, I think you'd probably agree. But then it's coupled with a team performance that's been brutal. And it's this yin and yang of emotion, of trying not, trying to balance the two out.
Like, put it this way, if we were in finals, you'd be in the All-Australian side as like a starting inside midfield. You've had that good a year. Like, how's it been performing excellently individually in a tough collective side?
Yeah, it's absolutely. I mean, I feel like I've had my strongest year by far. Obviously I was all Australian my second year with Geelong, but in terms of consistency, I definitely feel like this has been my most consistent and my best year. So I don't really care what anyone else says about that, just like Aussie, obviously Aussie's having a great year as well. It's tough, because there is that yin and yang, and you're playing good footy, but the ultimate goal is winning. Like we touched on, you want to play well, and you want to help your team win. Your output of your game doesn't really get, not that you're looking for any pats in the backs, but you don't really get spoken about unless you're winning.
Externally.
It doesn't really matter like what you're doing in game. It's the competition is based around winning, and that's what it comes down to. So it's been frustrating, but at the same time, obviously I understand where we're at as a club, and it's been a fair bit of change, and obviously a lot of injuries in that. The club sort of been hands been forced to play a lot of our young guys, and we're seeing development, and there's light at the end of the tunnel. Hmm.
Just on the weekend, 30 touches, 8 clearances, 5 goal assists, right?
Let's have a punt for under over for score involvements.
All right. Well, just on this, how many players do you think in the history of AFL footy have ever done that?
30
touches, 8 clearances, 5 goal assists in a game in the history of footy.
20?
3. Chris Judd in 2011, Patrick Dangerfield in 2016, Tim Kelly on the weekend. Like, that is a rare areas of, like, one of the great games, like, of all time.
He give you one of the three or not?
Yeah, he gave me the first one of the day. Your first goal assist of the day for the big fella.
I hit Aussie up pretty quickly, so.
Goal's gone.
It's always nice to get the boys on the board early. So, I think I actually saw that the other day as well.
I was going to repost it on my story last night. When I saw it, I was like, I've got to post this. I might do it now, actually.
Big gun show, were you, last night?
Oh, you know, I'll do it now.
pretty cool little stat. Judd's a big fan of Judd's. He's my favourite player. And obviously spent a few years with Dangerfield there and know him well. So, yeah. It's pretty cool.
You got another stat going on. It's active game streak of over 20 plus touches as well. You know who the winner is of that, Oz, at the moment? Who's leading that?
Yeah, Caleb Sarong is.
You're a freak of stats, Oz. You've got to get
out.
He's
a footy nerd, man. He gets a lot of the footy. How many have you had in a row?
Oh, mate, no idea.
I've got the answer somewhere. No idea. Yeah, I got it.
Go on.
24 now. It's the 24th game straight. Yeah, obviously, when you play. And track's on 34, Oliver's 30, 40 for Sarong. So you knew that one. Pritter's been in the club quite a bit of late. He was there for front row seats of Bunga's retirement with the Kleenex out, just wiping himself stupid in the eyes. and he also came and spoke to the AFLW team as well as they embark on their season as well. And they brought him in, talked a lot about the perseverance, determinations to push on over many overlooked drafts. And you're in the same position, TK. Went back and read some stuff around the South Frio, you know, continuing to go back, chisel away. What was it like? Obviously, easy going back and just working on stuff that you're told to go and work on. That's almost the easy stuff, even though it's continuous work.
Yeah.
It's more the mental strains that I wanted to ask you about, of having to pick yourself back up many times, because that's a different type of training and a different type of mental fortitude, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. It was obviously, obviously tough, getting the knock. Each year that, you know, I sort of put my hand up and thought that I was playing pretty good footy, as a young guy. I had to really work on my game, work on myself, get fitter, stronger, all those things. So I felt like I had the talent, but I'd probably agree with, my knockers to a certain extent that, I had some work to do. So, I felt like something's probably... each year that sort of went by, it was kind of, I guess, the hunger of like playing AFL never really went, but it was more like, okay, 2 years gone by, 3 years gone by, 4 years gone by. I don't really think it's going to happen. And then for me, it is like, I sort of loved the game so much that I just wanted to, loved the club I was at, South Fremantle. Shout out South Fremantle. Yeah. So I just wanted to be the best player that I could be and play as high as I could, for as long as I could. So, if that meant that I was going to, go on to hopefully play 200 games for the Bulldogs, then that'd be unreal. So, but in that, just by, working on myself and not really overthinking and just playing footy and having fun, I started playing some really good footy. 2016 had a really good year. Played with the state team, and then backed it up again 2017. All of a sudden, a few clubs start making contact, and it was probably similar conversations I'd already sort of had in the past, but sort of gathered a bit more traction than it has in the past. And yeah, invited a national combine in the end. That
when you were with Dogs,
went over there with Aussie. So me and Aussie first met. And
that was the first time you got a combine invite. It was that year, is that what you're
saying? I'd been invited to a state combine, but that's when I think you need like two or three. This is when there's, many clubs involved. So, it was nice to get invited to the draft combine, the national draft combine.
So nationally you need like eight clubs to say you need a fair few. We've got interest in drafting,
Gotcha. So
did you know you're kind of home at that point?
Well, no, I mean, you never really get your hopes up. I never really got my hopes up. But I just felt like, as a mature ager, there was sort of, it felt like clubs were starting to look at those guys a little bit more. A little bit more plug and play, you know, can rock up day one and just be ready to go. So it's
You said that, like the mid-20s that were being drafted sort of never, you know, extinguished the flame for yourself because you saw that other mature ages were getting that tick, right?
Yeah, yeah. So I felt like, you know, I fitted that category nicely and it just you know, depended on you know, what clubs were looking for and where they're at with their list. And I guess, you know, in the end, you know, I'll, you know, forever be grateful to Geelong for the opportunity they gave me and absolutely, you know, loved my time there. And, you know, obviously having a young family, it was, you know, we had our challenges over there and, you know, the opportunity to come back home came, popped up and been loving my time ever since getting to the club, just got to get back to our winning ways.
Mm. When you were grinding away, improving every year, becoming a better footballer, what were you doing full time for work? Like, have you got a trade? Like, what can TK do off the footy field?
Yeah, I'm a Sparky, so I've got my license now.
Like fully qualified,
fully
TK.
Fully qualified, yeah.
It's
fully
not
qualified.
Like Dom who tells people he's a Sparky.
Anything. Not like Dom. I actually got my license. You know, which, you know, is good. Like, you know, obviously footy's not going to be forever. You need something to fall back on. Hopefully I don't.
You don't want to crawl on some roofs?
Nah.
Anytime soon?
Look, it's not something I really see myself doing post-footy. Who knows? Maybe maybe the one coming
or something like that.
You know, maybe the guy calling the shots, you know, supervising and setting things up. But, you know, I'm still working on, I guess, what life after footy looks like for me. You know, not really too sure yet.
You got some time there too.
I guess just trying to ride this out as long as I can and then we'll see what happens. But yeah, I was a electrical apprentice before getting drafted. And yeah, I enjoyed it. It was cool. You know, working on getting a trade and then I reckon I got drafted and then my apprenticeship had to get put on hold. So at the end of my first year, I sort of, when I came back home to have Chrissy break, I finished all my testing and off the job training and stuff like that. And
you remember it all?
So, hey?
You remember it all?
Nah, like I do little bits like here and there, like at home. But yeah, there's still some stuff that, you know, I got to call a couple of mates up for. Like,
yeah, you're not willing to do it yourself.
Yeah.
Well, Jack Higgins wants to know whether some of the boys have been hitting you up, you know, possible cashies or, just install this light switch for us, will you, TK? Anyone hitting you up around the playing group?
Nah, I don't reckon many of the playing groups know that. But, yeah, because whenever I tell them, they'll be like, oh, really? So I'm like, yeah.
so you've hidden it.
But, yeah, I reckon it's gone under the radar a little bit. I don't reckon too many boys know. But, yeah, I'll, you know. Always open to cashies.
Mate, none of the boys listen to this. Yeah. I think you sorted there.
Heading into the off season, big fella. What's the plans for the family? What are you guys going to do to unwind? You've had a terrific year. How are you going to celebrate?
Yeah, we haven't really we haven't travelled overseas for for a few years. I think last time we did, we went to Maldives, went to India at the end of 2019, just before getting to the club. So, definitely looking to get away with the fam. Thinking Bali, maybe sort of middle September, getting away with the fam. So, no, it'd be good. Like, let the fam unwind and have a ball and, yeah, just sort of have that nice mental break. You know, obviously been a tough couple of years and especially this year has been pretty tough. So, good physical break, good mental break. And then, yeah, other than that, probably just stay around here. You know, Broome sort of always pops up. You know, could do that again. But, yeah, just looking to kick back, relax and do me.
The funny thing when TK says with the fam, you just know that Jermaine Jones would be with you as well.
Oh,
is he just like an adopted member of the Kelly gang now? Because he just rolls with you guys wherever you go.
He's so funny. He's so good having around. Like obviously, he's been my one teammate from day one. So
of course,
when I was at the Cats, he was there. And when I came across, the club were interested to get him across too. So
put in a good word for him.
I did, put in a little word for him. So
mate, the back line owes you plenty there. Yeah. He's found a little niche back there. He's so important to that structure.
He has. So it's good, you know, those Gov, TB, Bunga, those boys, they do a great job in set marking and then JJ just time it, run past, get their hands and
get going. He breaks
let him
more.
Run. So Yeah, no, he's been good, but yeah, you're right. You're right. So, yeah, I'm sure JJ will be around a fair bit.
All right. So before we get to the fan questions, TK, it could be an emotional game Saturday night, bidding farewell to some close teammates and mates. How do you think you're going to find all the emotion as well as playing a game of AFL footy?
Yeah, I reckon you're right, mate. It's going to be it's a big game for a number of reasons. So, you know, but none more important than the fact that, you know, it's important we play the right way and we send off, you know, three absolute legends at our footy club and three guys who, you know, mean a hell of a lot to me and the playing group. So, you know, we'll be doing everything we can to make sure we do that. And it's going to be, it's going to be on. It's going to be on. So, no, I'm really excited about it. I think at times you can sort of go through the motions a little bit and sometimes you got to try and find little ways to get yourself up for a particular game. I don't think that's the case this week. Mm-hmm. It's pretty easy to be highly motivated, you know, to get the win and see our boys off the right way.
Did you two see Nick Nat's post on the gram last night of his sneaker room? You see that?
Yeah, I know he's got sneaker. I didn't see the post last.
Yeah, time. I didn't see the post either. But has he got like his PlayStation in there as well?
No, it's grown a lot since I last saw it. There is nothing else that can fit in this room besides the shoes now. Like it's lined on the floor and walls. It's ridiculous if it's still there. But have you seen it in the flesh, Oz? You would have saw it 2018 some point.
Yeah, I've seen it once or twice in the flesh. But for some reason, I thought he was talking about if it was going to get moved to a kid's room, and
as he'd be chewing on.
Yeah, so I'm not sure what he's doing with him, but he might be looking to sell him, the big fella. He's got a lot going on. He's finishing up playing footy.
Bit short of coin, is he?
Yeah, potentially. I don't know. Right. No, I think he'll be all right.
Wouldn't think so, but.
Nah, it's off his story now. There was so many shoes. Shannon Hearn, I don't know if you remember, he used to have Teddy, the property dude, bring like a portable mini fan that they would plug into his room and it would just blare and bung his face because he couldn't sleep without his fan.
Bull.
Nah, I didn't know if you knew that one. I don't think he still packs it anymore. If you could sneak an item on board without the boys knowing, TK, can't say family members. You reckon you'd sneak something on board? You got anything like that at home?
Well, is this for like when we travel away?
Trips? Yeah. He used to have the bunger fan.
Same
question to you, Oz, if you know that you can sneak something.
I'd probably bring like a PlayStation just to play with my guys. Like,
yeah, I was actually thinking that. Yeah. I'd probably say PlayStation. That'd be it for me.
To be fair, like a lot of the away trip now are just hanging out with the boys and depending on who's traveling and like a lot of my age demographic are playing every week now, me and younger. Like it's such a young group. The older guys a couple of years ago, it was like everyone's in their room doing their own thing. Like they don't really want to hang out. Like they've got their routines. The younger boys are just so excited. So there's always kids flying around and wanting to do things. So if you want to go get a coffee, go do whatever, someone's always there for you.
Yeah. A lot of plane chats.
Yeah. Plane chats are off the charts compared to what they used to be like.
Yeah. Which is great to see for an outside observer. People are just happy yarn.
There's a lot of movement like during the flight. There's a lot of card playing. There's a lot of just.
Bonus of the charter, right?
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah, well, you were there the other night.
Yeah, yeah, mate. It was happening. I wanted to be up and involved. I was like, I'll do my work. It's fine. if you don't, you can tell me to go long. Last question before the fans. But who did you vote for captain this year?
Who did I vote for captain? I voted for Shuey.
Why did you vote for Shuey?
Yeah, just, you talk about, caring for the club and caring for your mates and, caring for our supporter base, our fans. He leads for the front in all those categories, and obviously he's been our captain in the last couple of years. Been the captain since I've been at the club, and I've just loved having him as our number one guy who we're all right behind and leading this club out. So he's someone who's welcome me in with open arms from the day I got here, and looking forward to having one last ride with him, and hopefully he's going out with a bang.
Hopefully his body holds on. Mm. You ready for some fan questions, yeah, big fella?
I'll get into it.
All right, courtesy of Tab Touch. Oscar Allen, open the bowling.
We've got one from Fluffy Simba 101. How many tattoos do you have? Like, how many different sittings did you have for all your tattoos?
Okay, how many different sittings? I reckon I've had about 7 or 8 sittings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so most of mine I've got done in Bali. So, yeah, when I go over to Bali in the off-season.
You might be coming back with some fresh ink.
I'm going to be covered.
Yeah, have you got a dude? You got a dude that you see?
Yeah, Caitlin's got a Bali brother over there. Ever since I've been in the family, he's been like family. So his name's Tucky, and he owns one of the biggest tattoo studios over there, Luxury Ink. So I'll let a few boys know, but I'm sure he'd look after him, and always looks after me. So yeah, I wouldn't say I'd be covered. I already got the sleeve and a fair bit on my chest, and I want to get a little bit more on my leg and my other arm and stuff like that. So yeah, I could be covered, pre-season when I come back. So we'll see.
Quick one from me. Most painful place you got a tattoo so far?
Most painful? It's the elbow. Far for me.
I've heard that before.
Tip of
the elbow. Yeah.
Elbow.
On the nerves and stuff.
Yeah, I got like a big star on my elbow, and man, it just kills.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Tough. All right, on the subject of your partner, a massive congratulations for the engagement, TK.
Thanks, man.
Life going pretty well. And Teresa WC wants to know, how were you feeling leading up to the proposal to Caitlin? It was beautiful. Where were the nerves? Do you have a game plan?
Yeah, I was obviously really excited about it all. It's been a long time coming. We've actually, long story short, but technically we actually already were engaged. But when I did it, it was more of a promise. We're pretty young. I proposed to her, but it was more of a promise. There was no urgency to get married like within the, I think I was 19 at the time. So there was no urgency to like get married like straight away, but it was more like a promise, like one day, blah, blah, blah. So
sounds like the spark of your friendship taking but
like a few years later, you move to the other side, you have a few kids, you move to the other side of the country, come back, I already feel like we're married, we got the house, the kids, all the problems, everything. So, it was, she always reminded me every day, like, you're going to have to do it again, like, blah, blah, blah. Sweet. So, it was good, mate. She had no idea, she was surprised. We went out for lunch out in Cottesloe, and finished with a walk along the beach. And, I arranged for a couple of photographers to sort of be following me from a distance. And I just said at some point, I'll drop to my knee and, did the old, oh, babe, I'll take a photo of you like with the water like behind you, and okay. And then I was like, oh, turn around, like I'll get you looking out. What, really? Yeah, turn around. So she did, and then I was like, oh, you can turn around now. Turn around. I was on my knees. So it worked out well.
How was the photographer? Did she think, oh, you the West are following us again?
The photographers, they're sort of like good friends of ours now. So they've did a family shoot with us early in the year. So, it was good. They're lovely people, and I'm glad that they were able to capture those moments for us.
You done with the dog? You done one with the dogs yet?
No, I haven't.
It's coming though, isn't
it? Yeah, it's coming. From Tim Legend 66, how do you see yourself, and do you see yourself a leader amongst the Indigenous boys of the footy club? Because we've got a lot of them at the club, and like, from within the four walls, I see you as a leader for those fellas. How has that come about in your time here?
Yeah, definitely. I think for me, like, I'm probably someone who, I guess when it comes to, being a leader, and I feel like my biggest leadership quality is like doing it. So, I feel like I lead by, the way I play and the way I perform. And the last, I think I was saying this earlier, but I've had to get out of my comfort zone a little bit the last couple of years, just with, I'll touch on the Indigenous boys in a sec, but with the, our midfield, how it's been with,
just the turnover,
Boots and
Dommy's been injured.
Dommy hasn't really been there. Even last year, when Reto was sort of in and out, Gaffey's had his moments where he's been out. Playing with, I look to the left and right of me, and there's guys who playing with three other mids who probably have 10 games between them, you got to get outside your comfort zone and you know, have a little bit more one-on-one conversations with them, because you know they're looking around you know, to me, because I'm you know one of the more experienced guys in there. So I've enjoyed that sort of getting out of my comfort zone a little bit and you know trying to upskill and work with you know our young mids and you know develop them as quickly as I can and that's you know it's been good for me. In a way, like I'm helping them, but at the same time, it's helping me. So that's been good. And then, yeah, definitely, like with you know, we got a good group of young Indigenous boys here, and you know, Flynn's a leader of that group as well. Like he's been here for a while now, and yeah, we got a good group of us, and you know, it's good. We have like weekly catch ups with us at the start of the week, and. You know, little things like make sure that everyone knows what the week looks like, and
a few dinners in the week that we wouldn't be aware of. You know, catching up outside of the club.
We've had a couple. But yeah, it's just you know, it's good. A little group within a group, and yeah, we all just want the best for each other, and like you do for your teammates. So yeah, it's good.
What about Dayfray 94? Like, did you ever consider Freo as part of the coming back home?
Dayfray
94. Did you ever consider Freo when coming on back here? Or, you know, you talked about loving Juddy as a youngster. Was it just, mate, West Coast of my boys? That's where I want to be going.
When you're making these decisions, you never say never. You never say no. You know, when players are, I guess, wanting trades and stuff like that, you're silly if you don't hear clubs out or whatever. But yeah, for me, yeah, I was very strong getting to West Coast. And you know, I'm really happy with how everything's worked out. So yeah, that's no knock on Freo. It's just yeah, I grew up a massive West Coast supporter. You know, little things like when I was like year seven graduation, you get to stand up and say, like, you know, where do you see yourself when you get older? You know, where do I see myself? I'll be playing footy for West Coast Eagles. And anyone who tried to tell me any different, I'd tell them they're crazy. So little things like that was just like, you know, if I had the opportunity to get to West Coast, I'd do everything to make it happen. So, yeah, like I said, happy with how it worked out.
Mm. So this will probably be pretty self-explanatory, but from Little Bob 11, who was your favourite player growing up? Was it the Juddies of the world?
Yeah, Chris Judd. Yeah. As I touched on, he was my favourite player. I reckon as a young kid, I played more as a forward. I was like, you know, trying to just kick as many goals as I could. I reckon it wasn't until I got a little bit older and actually started watching the game. And yeah, I don't know, just the way he moved, the way he played. Yeah, all of a sudden it was like, no, I want to be a midfielder. Like I want to play like him. So yeah, it's that's where I guess it was like, no, I don't want to kick goals anymore. I want to kick it to the guys who are kicking the goals. You know, so it was it's crazy how. How some people can have impact on you, it was. I actually got to meet him. I went on the footy show. I think my first year when I was at Geelong, got to meet him.
Did you gush?
Yeah, big time. I had to get a photo with him, and favorite player.
Love that. All right, two questions to finish. Liv Floro, she's asked some good ones for the year. If you could try any extreme sport you've never done before, what would you choose?
Extreme sport.
Pretend the club don't know. Pretend they don't listen to this potty. What are you doing in the off season?
Extreme sport.
What would you do, Oz?
I'm trying to think.
I do like skiing and snowboarding. Like the snow, like doing that. So I
need more extreme than that.
All right.
There are some bunny runs.
Gone skydiving.
Would you want it?
Yeah, so my brother and sister.
I'd never do that.
Yeah, my brother and sister have done it. I haven't. So
I'm with you, TK. No,
I'd never do that.
I don't actually know what I do. Like I'm pretty. I don't know. You know, like Caitlin, like I'm pretty boring. outside of playing footy, there's not a hell of a lot I do. I'm not really too sure, mate.
All right. Last question. Thumpalicious, worth a follow. How upset were you when Jermaine Jones showed the world his screensaver on an Eagles Instagram post?
Yeah, I was pretty flat. I was pretty flat because I feel like I've got a lot of dirt on him, like in my phone, but at the same time, he probably has a bit more on me. So,
what was the image of?
I was pretty. Hey,
what was the image of for those at home?
I'm not going to say because I reckon you're going to try. I reckon when I'm watching this, you're going to get,
it's gonna
get
be the put
photo
up.
Get the photo up, but yeah.
Well, he'll be sending it to me. So cheers, JJ.
The ones you saw, we'll see. But yeah, it was one of those like little blasts from the past photos of when you're a bit younger and that. So yeah, but
hey, you look good.
Yeah, I was pretty flat when I saw it. I was like, really, bros? Like, you're going to do me like that? So, So I told him, I said, mate, tread carefully because, I've got some ammo here.
Yeah, you return serve. Yeah. All right, love it, mate. No better way to cap off the year in the studio here. It was great waiting for you. Thanks for coming in. You're busier than the average bear, and we appreciate that. And that is it for Coast to Coast for 2023 and our guest, Oz. So thank you, TK. All the best for the year. Enjoy the last game. Hope you chop it up with the two boys and have a beer with Nick Nat afterwards.
That's it. Thanks, boys. Cheers.
Thanks, bro.
Cheers.